Yeah, we're gonna have slowly. Shall we start? Bit more dancing. Hello, everyone. Hello, girls and boys. Leo says hello. Today, we're going to read a story. And we've got a little drink while we sit and listen to the story. So if you find a comfortable place to sit, and then we'll start. I'll put Leo on the sofa over there with his friends. So everyone, today I thought we could read a story which I read when I was your age. And it's called The Wonderful World of Night. And it's by a woman called Marion Koenig. I won this book as a prize for my hard work and my progress. So I'm really happy to be able to share it with you today. Are you sitting comfortably? Then I'll begin. The sun is setting. Soon it will be night. Katie and John have played hard all day. And now Katie yawns. And John yawns too. Bedtime, calls Mother. Only 5 minutes more, begs Katie. But she doesn't really mean it. She is already half asleep. The long black shape of Simon, the cat, uncoils from his pillow and stretches. He yawns, and at once he is wide awake. As night falls, Simon's day begins. Simon is a hunter. He strolls off down the path and makes for the pool where the fat carp lives. The grass sways as Simon moves through it. Otherwise, there is no sound. Bats wheel overhead in search of insects. A cloud of insects settles down on the pool. The big carp hears them and he silently flits up through the water to gobble them up. Bloop, bloop, goes his round mouth, breaking the surface. Simon pounces, misses, and falls into the pool with a splash. The carp, that's a big fish, everybody, the carp disappears into the mud at the bottom of the pool. A hedgehog, who had come down to the pool to drink, pauses, then scuttles back into the shelter of a bush. Simon scrabbles ashore. Cross. It's fallen in the pond, everybody. Let's continue. Someone else would have also liked to eat that carp. Two small black eyes watch Simon shake his wet fur. Whiskers twitch, and the wide flat head of an otter peers out of a hole in the hollow tree where she has her holt. That's her home. Can you see the otter? She does not like company and waits until Simon has gone off up the hill before she and her children slip into the speckled water to hunt for their breakfast. A big full moon rises up into the late summer sky, putting a glittering magic on water and trees. The daytime colours have turned into light and dark shadows. In this shadowy world, Simon is at home. He stalks along a path with his tail held high. The path goes uphill past a quarry. You see the shimmering moon on the pond. Suddenly, he stops. He has heard something. A scuffling, snuffling, grunting noise in the fern by the path. Does it come from a friend or an enemy? A moment later, the fronds of bracken part and out lumbers a badger, followed by his family. Baby badger stops to look at a beetle and then a little brown vole swinging on a thistle. But a quick nudge from his mother sends him on his way. Can you see the badgers? They are secretive and like to hide. Simon goes up the path, ears pricked for the slightest sound. His hungry inside tells him it is time to eat. His tummy is rumbling. The moonlit path leads into a spinney. A small night breeze rustles the trees and the leaves overhead, but the busy sounds made by night creatures stop as Simon comes down the path. Only the anxious form of a mouse scurries out of the shadows. Simon becomes still and very watchful. I think a spinney is a clearing in the middle of the forest. And perched on a branch in a tree close by, the tawny owl is watchful too. His big round eyes glare down at the mouse. But just as Simon's paw steals out and the owl swoops, a cloud sails across the face of the moon. In the sudden darkness, the little mouse escapes. When the moon sweeps out again, calm and serene, the mouse has gone and the owl flies away. The mouse escapes, so he's not going to be dinner for the owl or Simon today. Shall we continue? Let's find out what else Simon meets on his night journey. A little further on, the spinney or the clearing becomes a deeper wood. Simon hardly makes a sound as he slides through the undergrowth, but the sharp ears of a resting deer pick up the smallest rustle. Up flashes his head and gives Simon a dreadful start or shock. Simon is out of luck tonight. Even the rabbits, which live around the edge of the wood, dart into their burrows. But not because of Simon. They have seen the red fox slink towards them along the hedgerows. Simon watches, hidden by the grass. Can you see the fox? When at last Simon comes out of the wood into the dewy meadow, there is mist on the ground and a line of light spreading up through the sky. The grey, ghostly world lies waiting for the dawn. Cows lie munching in the meadows and two cock pheasants stand alert, ready to run for cover. One sleepy bird calls out to another. As the light grows brighter and the first ray of sunshine cuts down through the mist, every bird in the wood and meadow sings out to greet the day. A heron, still as a post, stops hunting for frogs by the brook and watches Simon as he trots purposely home in the early morning sunshine. Can you see the heron and the kingfisher? It's a beautiful bird, the kingfisher. And here he comes, bounding through the window, just as Katie and John run downstairs to have their breakfast. Their day begins as his is ending. His wonderful world of night. So while they've been asleep, Simon's been out in the wonderful world of night. I hope you enjoyed The Wonderful World of Night, written by Marion Koenig, and drawings and paintings, that's the illustrations, by David Parry. Thanks for joining us today, everybody. See you next time, and maybe you could do a bit of reading. See you next time. Stay safe.